and welcome to Working With What You Got. I'm your host, Renee Joshua Porter, and I am so glad that you decided to join us today. Remember, our show is all about you realizing that you have more than you think you have. You have more time, you have more talent, you have more resources, you have more faith, you have more people on your side, and it is time to unknot your mind. Well, we're going to start our show like we do every week, and we're going to cook. Now you're going to say, what are we going to cook? Well, we're going to make some snacks, treats, and sweets, and we're going to work with what we got. What do we have? Well, I happen to like different types of Nutri-Bars. Now I have an issue because most of the time they're filled with a lot of junk. Then I also have to share them with my sons who eat like it's an Olympic sport. So it becomes costly. So I have to find a way to create these bars so that they're affordable and they stretch. What am I going to use? I was thinking and thinking and thinking. How can I make it affordable? So I decided to use as a base, guess what? Plantain chips. Plantain chips for $1. High in fiber, high in phosphorus. They are the bomb.com. So we have 1 cup of plantain chips. I'm going to put it in our processor. Let me put this over here so I'm not blocking. Our mini processor, we have our plantain chips. What else are we going to use? Well, why not some nuts? We have cashews, walnuts, and raisins. Probably about 1/4 cup. We're going to put it in here with the plantains. That's it. Cashews, walnuts, raisins, plantain chips. Now remember, if you don't have cashews and maybe you have almonds, work with what you got. This is what I had. It was in my mother's cabinet. I brought it. All right? I'm chopping it very finely. One of the wonderful things that I really enjoy is really just going to my cupboard, going to my mom's cupboard, and figuring, what do we have? What can we do? Plantain chips are something that we happen to really love. So any use for them is good with me. So I chop them up. I'm going to put them in my bowl. Let's get it out. Then what I'm going to do is I put in some flax seeds. We know how good flax is for you, right? Normally I use the refrigerated flax meal. We were out, so I had some flax seeds. Maybe about a quarter teaspoon of flax seeds. So we have our mixture, all our dry ingredients, and then you know from watching how much I love coconut oil. Coconut oil is wonderful for you. Takes the parasites out the body. It's an emollient. It has so many good things. So what I did was I'm taking, really that's about 2 tablespoons of coconut oil. And I'm mixing the dry ingredients together. Can you see me? Mixing them together. Now, whatever sweetener you use is up to you. Most of the time we'll use agave. Sometimes we'll use stevia. I had a dark honey, so I'm going to put the dark honey in there. And you sweeten it according to your taste. See how we're just mixing it together? And I'm always trying to find different uses for fruit spreads, and I have an apricot fruit spread. And I'm just going to take a little bit and put in there. You don't need it, but in case you like apricots like I do, why not? Another reason that I use the fruit spread and the coconut oil is because it keeps your bar moist. I don't like it dry. I like it chewy. So we're mixing it together. Simple, right? Simple. Look at that. So you can see the consistency. We use our plantain chips, we use walnuts, we use cashews, raisins, a little bit of apricot
fruit spread, and some honey. That's it. Now what I have is a silicone cookie sheet. I love silicone because nothing sticks in silicone. Take it, spoon it right in there. Okay, and then what we did was we just refrigerated it. You can do it overnight or just for a couple hours. And guess what? You have a bar. Now, I have a wonderful guest here today. Her name is Brenda, and these we made already. So I'm going to pop these out, and I'm going to see if Brenda is willing to try the bars that we did already. All right, Bren, you are the next contestant. All right. Come on, come close. Brenda doesn't have a mic, so she has to get kind of close to me. All right, you can pick it up or you can use your fork. Let's see what you think.
Mmm, delicious.
You like it?
Very good. Very good.
Now, how do you feel about the, would you use more flavors? Would you use some cinnamon? What do you think? Anything missing?
For me, this is sweet enough to have with tea.
Okay.
It's perfect.
Yeah, you like it, huh?
I love it very much.
Would you know plantain was in there?
No, not at all.
Not at all.
I wouldn't know apricot was in here. It's everything blends is very nice.
Okay.
Very, very good.
And she's not even getting paid to say this. All right. You like it? Okay.
Yes. Oh, thank you so much.
You're welcome. See how simple that was? You worked with what you have. Okay, we're going to make something else. I love it. Thank you, Brenda.
You're welcome. Thank you.
All right. So now what we're going to make is we are going to make chocolate popcorn. What I did is I go in the grocery aisle, and I don't buy cereal. And if I do buy cereal, I only buy a puffed grain because I know I can control what's in it. I don't want that other stuff with all that other junk up in there. So I get a simple puffed grain. And you know what's so wonderful about a simple puffed grain? It could be puffed millet. It could be puffed barley. It could be puffed rice or puffed corn. I got puffed corn this time. There's corn sometimes. It's an allergen for a lot of people. But that's what I found, and that's what I had. Guess what? A bag of puff corn is $1.50. $1.50, you know what we could do with this? $1.50. So now, what I did was, we're going to take a cup of our puff corn over here. I have plain cocoa powder, unsweetened, nothing in it, no milk, no additives, just 100% cocoa. Cocoa powder, right here, half a cup. I'm only going to use some of it. Again, I'm using my friend, the coconut oil. Stirring it into the powder. It kind of gets kind of gummy. Put a little bit more in there, equivalent to 2 teaspoons. Uh-oh, making a mess. Stir it up in there. I really should have put it in the bowl first. Go ahead and put our honey in there. Mix it together. And now what we're going to do is we toss it right over our corn. My kids like sweet, so probably they would put a little bit more agave in there. Agave or honey. What we did, we got a plate with some parchment paper and put it in the refrigerator. Tell me this is not a good snack if you go into the movie theater. Why do you want to pay $6 for a whole bunch of junk, right? This may happen to be at the bottom of your pocketbook when you get into the theater and you happen to take it out when it's dark. I'm just saying, you know. I'm not telling you to do anything wrong. I'm just saying just by chance if it happens to be in the bottom of your bag. All right, this is what it's going to look like. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? Okay, Bren, you ready to come back? Brenda's going to try our chocolate popcorn. It's sticky and delicious. It is not too sweet.
Oh, very good.
Mm-hmm. Are you a chocolate lover?
I love chocolate. Mm. Yes. Thank you. This is delicious.
It's delicious, right?
Yes.
$1.50 for the popcorn. Mm.
Thank you. Delicious.
Delicious, right? Simple. Now, our last thing, I'm going to show you another real quick, easy treat. We like things spicy. I do. We're going to take 1/4 of a teaspoon of the coconut oil. And what we did, we used a hot stick, non-stick pan, and we put our seasonings together. The seasoning is cayenne, granulated onion powder, granulated garlic, and sea salt. That's it. Put it in here. And now we're going to put some more of our corn. And just toss it. Just pop it for maybe a minute. And now we have our spicy popcorn. We got a lot of cayenne in here. I can smell it. Nothing we made is over $5. You can do a lot with that puff green, I'm telling you. Forgo the expensive $4 or $5 box of cereal that's really filled with a whole bunch of junk and just get yourself a bag of $1.50 puffed grain. Any puff grain will work. All right. I don't know, Brenda, do you like hot spicy stuff? If you don't like hot and spicy, I don't want to mess you up. You do? Oh, Brenda is the bomb.com. She likes everything I like. Come on. All right. We don't have an extra plate. It has a kick to it. I don't want to give you too much spice. Okay.
Good.
That's good, right? That's a little
very
heat
good
to it.
And spicy.
It's
yes,
spicy.
Very good.
I'll give you a little bit extra that you can share with your sisters.
Thank you.
Look at that. We made spicy popcorn. We made chocolate popcorn. We made our own bar. Come on. There's nothing that you can't do. If I can do it, you can do it. You can work with what you got. You have options. Stop saying that you can't. You have more than you think you have, and it is time for you to unknot your mind. We are going to come back after this commercial break with Dr. Deanna Howard. Oh, it's going to be on and popping. See you in a little bit.
Hi, my name is Dr. Tom Dow. We have a multidiscipline practice in Melville and Ronkonkoma, New York, and we treat patients with many, many different conditions, from newborns through geriatric patients with numerous different techniques. There's a technique and a type of treatment for every class of patient. We have them all here. Here's my son Thomas, also a doctor of chiropractic, working on one of our patients' cervical spine. This patient has had chronic neck pain for many, many, many years, has been to a multitude of different practitioners with little or no response. And with our specialized techniques, she has improved tremendously and continues to improve on a daily basis. We have two practices, one in Melville and one in Ronkonkoma, New York. We are a multi-discipline chiropractic office. What that means is we have chiropractors, massage therapists, acupuncturists, psychologists, all working as a team and a network of outside professionals such as orthopedists and neurologists that we work hand in hand with to help determine what your injuries are and the best way to treat your injuries. I have the great pleasure of having my son in practice with me. We work hand in hand, father and son, to give our patients the best care possible, and a staff which is loving, caring, and you'll never have to wait at all in our office for service. Many times patients come into our office and they have what's called a soft tissue injury. Soft tissue injuries are like scars inside your body. If you've ever been cut on the outside of your body, you get a scar. The same thing happens inside of your body to your muscles and ligaments. So our job is to determine where those are, stretch the muscles, adjust the vertebra back into their correct position, and then refortify normal structure with exercise.
That's what we do best,
and I hope someday you'll come see us at one of our two offices. Thank you.
My name is Dr. Robert Brevard. I'm here for Multimedicine in Westbury, New York. We're located at 1065 Old Country Road, Suite 214. Been here for about 15 years. The practice has medical doctors, physical therapists, chiropractors, acupuncturists. We also do pain management, and we have orthopedists on staff. Here at Advanced Multimedicine Rehabilitation, we've got physical therapists on staff who treat an array of conditions, from neck pain to back pain, shoulder pain. We treat carpal tunnel. We treat a lot of car accident patients, slip and falls. We treat patients with knee injuries, with ankle injuries. We have state-of-the-art equipment. We've been here for over 15 years. Vast array of diagnostic testing, from x-rays to EMGs. What is an EMG? It's a diagnostic test that allows a doctor to determine where the pinched nerve is. Cora is a physical therapist at Advanced Multimedicine and Rehabilitation. She's working on Stephanie, who was involved recently in an automobile accident. Stephanie has tight thoracic and cervical musculature, and Cora is doing some myofascial release work and some therapeutic stretching to help her with her pain. Vicky is also a patient here at Advanced Multimedicine and Rehabilitation. Vicky is now working her leg muscles, specifically her quadricep muscles, trying to strengthen them after an injury she sustained. Find yourself in need of any type of physical therapy, please don't hesitate to call Advanced Multimedicine and Rehabilitation, located in Westbury, New York, in Suite 214. Phone number is 516-334-7000, or find us on our website at advancedmultimedicine.com.
Hi, and welcome to Working With What You Got's Rant of the Week, where I rant about various things that bug me. So let's get into it. Today I'm going to rant about higher education. Now, as a recent college grad, I realized that some majors get no love, no respect, no nothing. Tell someone you're a liberal arts major, you hear crickets. Tell someone you majored in chemistry or engineering, you get, oh wow, that's so impressive, tell me more. Now, to be clear, I do think the American public school system should encourage more students, especially minorities, to pursue STEM education. And when I say STEM, I'm referring to science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Many countries have surpassed us in those areas, and they do need to be pursued. But let's be real, everybody is not meant to be a doctor, a lawyer, or an engineer. It is what it is. Instead of encouraging young people to pursue what we think they should pursue or what society says is most important, how about we encourage people to pursue their passion? If your passion is medicine, pursue that. That's great. If your passion is classical music, that's great too. No one should be defined by their degree. We're all diverse individuals with different goals and interests, and I think they all deserve to be explored. No college student who spent thousands of dollars in debt, countless supplies of ramen noodles, sat through boring lectures, wrote research papers, sitting through boring lectures, just anyway. No college grad should be made to feel like they are less valuable to society because of their degree. That's absolutely ridiculous to me. I think it's not so much about the degree, but about the character of the person behind the degree. Now, to all my liberal arts people out there, please don't be discouraged. Here are some very notable people who were also liberal arts majors, and somehow they were able to make something of themselves. Perhaps you've heard of President John F. Kennedy, the one and only Oprah Winfrey, director Steven Spielberg, Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor, and last but not least, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther the King, Jr. See, they all managed to use their liberal arts major to change the world and to change lives. So don't be discouraged. There's light at the end of the tunnel. Well, that's my thoughts. Thank you for listening. See you next time.
Thank you, Mooks. She has a lot to say. Food for thought. Well, we're back. I'm Renee Joshua Porter, and I have a wonderful guest with me today. I have Dr. Deanna Howard, who's an OBGYN physician. She happens to be my personal physician also, and she is the bomb.com. Thank you so much for being here today.
Thank you, Renee. Thank you for having me.
Okay, now tell us again where your practice is located.
My primary practice is in Livingston, New Jersey.
Okay.
It's called Women and Wellness. And I practice, I used to do obstetrics. I don't do obstetrics anymore. I do like to sleep.
Okay.
So I'm doing gynecology, and my spin on it is that I do holistic gynecology.
Now, that was one of the things that really drew me to Dr. Howard. When I went about searching for a GYN physician, I really was hoping I could find an MD that also believed in holistic medicine. Mm-hmm. And it was very hard to come by, but you are that. Now, first tell us, how did you get to that space? How did you evolve into integrative medicine?
It was a journey for me. I have two sisters who are older than me. Mm-hmm. And so they were always, you know, when different things were going on, because there's a number of years between us. So they were adults by the time I was a teenager. So they always had all kinds of teas all over the place, and they didn't take any kind of medicines for anything. And, they were eating clean. They were eating lots of vegetables and whatever protein, a lot of fish primarily, and some chicken. But, they were having all kinds of herbal teas. Like, you didn't see them, you know, like tea bags.
Right.
They had loose herbs. Mm-hmm. And so they would cook up whatever for whatever was going on, for whatever you thought was a problem. And
right.
They'd tell you, use this, use that, you know. So that's what got me started thinking that way.
Okay.
And when I decided to become a doctor, and I went through medical school, and when you go through medical training, there's no nutritional training whatsoever, at least when I went, and that's back in the day.
Right.
So there's no nutritional training. You learn a little bit about vitamins, but only in the context of maybe chemistry and biology in that context, but you don't learn a lot more about it other than maybe what a deficiency might look like, what a person might have. So
gotcha.
There might be some B vitamin deficiency that will cause nervous system disorders or other disorders, and so you learn about it in that context, but you don't learn about it in depth. And I always thought that, well, there's gotta be more. You know, somewhere in the back of my brain, I kept feeling like, okay, there's got to be more. And for me, a pill, to pop a pill for whatever ails you, just seemed like overkill. I just thought that God put everything here on this planet. And so what was put here on the planet has to be of use.
It has to be of use, exactly.
And then what confirmed that for me is that every single medicine that, you know, like if you start delving into
the origins of it,
mm-hmm. came from something, from some plant,
yeah,
or something
botanical,
else.
Yeah.
You know, so you'll, okay, well, why are they using just this small part? And so, you know, that I had these questions in the back of my mind that over time just grew. So, but you know, medical school training is rigorous. You don't have a lot of time to do a lot of things. When I did my residency, I found a holistic doctor that actually worked not far from where I was going to medical school.
Okay.
Not far from where I was training. And, you know, when I could, I would spend some time in his office. And I just started learning then about my horizons got even broader. Acupuncture, kinesiology. I never even knew what the kinesiology was.
Right.
Which is the study of muscle testing against, you know, different ailments or medications or even herbs, whether or not that would be what your body needed.
Okay.
So residency is even more rigorous than medical school. And so at some point in time, I had to stop that because I was burning out. So when I finished my training in residency, then I began my practice. And I went to upstate New York. And while I was there, I still was, you know, on the learning curve of learning about other alternative things or what some people would call complementary things to do. But still, you know, like I would talk to my patients about, you know, taking supplements, getting enough rest, eating good food.
Let me ask you this. When you started putting that into your practice, did you find a lot of support from colleagues? I mean, did you find that there were colleagues that had that same method, or did you feel
not really. I mean, they just kind of looked at me, you know. They kind of thought like that I was probably strange.
Okay.
They wouldn't tell me necessarily directly, but they probably thought that I was strange because I would just get this kind of look, you know, like kind of a deer in the headlights, like, what?
Right.
So
now.
But that didn't deter me because.
You were convinced.
I had passion about it, and
right.
I was convinced. And just from things that I would tell, say, some of the nurses who I work with, you know, do this. You know, I had nurses who were sick when they were pregnant. And so I would say, okay, well, have some mint tea or have some peppermint tea, and they would be fine, you know, instead of taking some sort of prescription medication.
Right. Now, let me ask you, what are some of the common ailments that you've seen a real momentum, you know, an increase of in your practice recently among women? Anything you think that maybe 10 years ago it wasn't that much?
Well, weight for sure.
Yes.
You know, obesity is an epidemic, you know, in America. And I contribute a lot of that to fast food, but I also contribute a lot of that to people just eating out generally. When you eat out generally, you have no control over what's on your plate.
Right.
And for most restaurants don't list calorie counts. You know, it's just starting to become a thing now where people have to start listing calorie counts.
Okay.
Now, I like Cheesecake Factory. I don't know about you. But every now and then, I like to go there. And,
yes.
You know, like if you look at, say, for an example, one of their desserts, it's the calorie count is what you would actually have for half of your calories for the day.
Wow.
You know, like if you have over 1,000 calories in a dessert, that's excessive. And all of that extra sugar, it's going to go right to the hips.
Right, yes.
But people don't necessarily think about it that way. Anything that we eat that's excess sugar is going to turn to fat. That's what the body does with it. Because sugar is one of the foods that we eat not only for energy, but for fat storage. And so there's a whole thing that goes on. You eat too much sugar for that particular meal.
Okay.
Your insulin level skyrockets because your body's just like, okay, we have to handle this because it's out of balance now. So the insulin level increases. And insulin, you can think about it this way. Insulin insulates us.
Okay.
And what is insulation? Fat.
Fat.
And so when the sugar level is too high, our body pumps out a bunch of insulin.
Okay.
So that insulin then will lower the sugar level, sometimes too much. And so that's why some people will then feel like maybe half an hour after eating some sugary meal or drink that they feel tired because now you're having a crash.
Now let me ask you this. I've seen so many people that are dependent on stimulants and they don't even realize it.
Yeah.
So they have to have that coffee.
Mm-hmm.
And then with that coffee, they have to have four sugars in it.
Mm-hmm.
And then with the coffee with the four sugars, then they have the muffin,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
You know, or then they may have for lunch, they have a bagel.
Mm-hmm.
And sugar, sugar, sugar.
Mm-hmm.
And do you find that people are really going through, especially maybe even women,
mm-hmm.
are going through their life not really knowing what their body can do and how it can operate without stimulus?
Right.
Because they've just been programmed. How do you break that?
Gradually.
Okay.
Gradually. Because with the stimulants, the problem is this. It's like you've set off the alarm to the firehouse. Okay? Mm-hmm. So now you've had your coffee, and if you've had a Starbucks coffee, that's definitely more than 8 ounces.
Right.
Okay? So what that does is it says to your adrenal glands, wake up, let's go, we have an emergency. It tells your body, we have a dire emergency, let's get in gear. So your adrenaline levels go up. So then that's where people get the energy kick, because the adrenal glands have now started to work in overtime.
Okay.
To pump out epinephrine. Or norepinephrine, essentially, you know, the adrenal hormones.
Okay.
So those adrenal hormones, normally there's something that's called fight or flight response. Every animal has it. And so what it does is that if we have an emergency, like back in the day when we used to run from tigers, mm-hmm. that we don't have to run from anymore, but back in the day when we had to fight for our lives or run for our lives, those hormones would get released so that we would be able to take action. But most people, they're going to have their nice latte and sit and go to the office. They're going to sit at their office desk and do their work. They're not doing anything physical. There's no emergency. So you've alerted your adrenal glands for essentially nothing.
Wow.
And so what happens over time is that when you keep pressing that emergency button, the adrenal glands get tired. They get worn out.
Is that what's called adrenal fatigue?
Yes. They get adrenal fatigue. And when it gets worse, adrenal exhaustion.
Mm, what does that look like?
That's people who, you know, like they have problems sleeping. They can't get up. They may sleep, but then when they wake up, they're still dog tired. Their cortisol levels get shifted. Normally in the morning, our cortisol levels increase so that it wakes us up. And then through the day, it keeps, sliding down, getting lower, so that at nighttime, it's at a level where it's not going to keep us awake so we can go to sleep.
Gotcha.
So all of our hormones, they're supposed to work in balance with each other. You know, there's things that go on. Our hormone levels are changing all the time. And, you know, really, I don't think we have adequate testing, because you'd have to test somebody all day long, because all hormones are all changing and they're all messengers. And it's like a beautiful dance. You know, it's like a symphony with an orchestra. You know, they're individual instruments, but together mm-hmm. they're creating this harmony within us to keep us alive, awake, and functioning, and able to do the things that we do.
Now, okay, so with that being said, is that the reason why so many women seem to be operating so erratic? I mean, sometimes you just find where they'll blame it on their cycle, or they blame it on the kids or husband or whatever, and really they don't realize that it's internal.
Right. Well,
there's a lot of factors.
Yeah, there's a lot of factors.
So
there's disharmony internally.
Okay.
There may be disharmony externally with, you know, a lot of people have stressful jobs. A lot of people have jobs that they don't like.
Mm.
That's a whole nother story.
And that can throw off your health?
Sure, because stress affects everything. Everything. There's nothing it doesn't affect.
Wow.
And you can get interesting, you know, You hear about people who have anxiety, and they're having palpitations, their heart's racing, and they're sweating, and they feel like, you know, they might feel like they're going to die. But what they're having is an anxiety attack.
So what are the
because
warning
of stress.
Signs? What are the warning signs that should not be ignored?
I think that if you're having sleep issues, you shouldn't ignore that. If you need coffee to get you through the day, especially if you're having more than one cup, if you're having 2, 3, 4, 5 or more cups of coffee a day, you're heading down a road that is extremely dangerous.
Mm.
And there's little steps that a person can take. You know, just for example, if you're having a hard time sleeping, maybe you need some magnesium. So maybe if you go to sleep and you feel like either you're waking up multiple times in the night, or you sleep, but it's a light sleep, it's, you know, not really a restful sleep, maybe you need a little magnesium at night to start to help you before you start adding in other things.
You mean magnesium the supplement?
Magnesium the supplement.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. That's a doable change.
Yeah. And of course, like, if you're a person who is stressed, and, you know, with this economy, a lot of people are extra stressed, it might be a good idea to start taking some B-complex.
Okay.
You know, and start weaning down the coffee. If you have an issue with coffee or other stimulants, start weaning those things down, increasing your water intake. Because as you're drinking all these caffeinated beverages, which are stimulating you so that you feel like you have energy.
You're dehydrated.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what's happening. And then that sets up a whole nother set of symptoms that happens. It's harder to think when you're dehydrated, because your brain wants water more than any organ. The brain is like 80% water.
The brain wants water.
The brain wants water, and it will steal it from any other organ it can get it from. And it does not care, and it does not discriminate, as long as it gets what it wants.
Wow.
And so even though it's a minor thing like headaches, can be fixed with hydrating yourself properly with water.
I love that you said that, because when my children tell me that they have headaches, that's the first thing I say. Did you drink enough water today?
You go, girl.
Yeah. Hey, so now you heard the doctor said that. Wow, that is great. Well, we'll be right back. I have a bunch of questions for you right after this.
Are you planning an event and want to include entertainment, but you're not sure where to turn? Act1Entertainment.net has provided over 1,500 events with quality, affordable live entertainment at private parties, corporate affairs, festivals, bike rallies, and more. Act One will fit into your budget. They're friendly, reliable, and do all the legwork for you. They take all major credit cards. Log on to Act1Entertainment.net for a free, no-obligation price quote, or call 631-758-3505 for a brochure. You'll be happy you did.
Hi, my name is Dr. Tom Dow. We have a multidiscipline practice in Melville and Ronkonkoma, New York, and we treat patients with many, many different conditions, from newborns through geriatric patients with numerous different techniques. There's a technique and a type of treatment for every class of patient. We have them all here. Here's my son Thomas, also a doctor of chiropractic, working on one of our patients' cervical spine. This patient has had chronic neck pain for many, many, many years, has been to a multitude of different practitioners with little or no response. And with our specialized techniques, she has improved tremendously and continues to improve on a daily basis. We have two practices, one in Melville and one in Ronkonkoma, New York. We are a multidiscipline chiropractic office. What that means is we have chiropractors, massage therapists, acupuncturists, psychologists, all working as a team and a network of outside professionals such as orthopedists and neurologists that we work hand in hand with to help determine what your injuries are and the best way to treat your injuries. I have the great pleasure of having my son in practice with me. We work hand in hand, father and son, to give our patients the best care possible and a staff which is loving, caring, and you'll never have to wait at all in our office for service. Many times patients come into our office and they have what's called a soft tissue injury. Soft tissue injuries are like scars inside your body. If you've ever been cut on the outside of your body, you get a scar. The same thing happens inside of your body to your muscles and ligaments. So our job is to determine where those are, stretch the muscles, adjust the vertebra back into their correct position, and then re-fortify normal structure with exercise.
That's what we do best,
and I hope someday you'll come see us at one of our two offices. Thank you.
To working with what you got. I have Dr. Deanna Howard here. She is a gynecologist. She has a practice in Livingston, New Jersey. Thank you for coming. And
Thank you.
She was giving us the 411 about caffeine, about all kinds of stuff. Okay, I'm going to throw some stuff at you, Doc.
Okay,
and you tell me what you think. Now, I have a relative, right? She's, you know, up there in age, and she's...
How up there?
Well, maybe in her 70s.
Okay.
She's in her 70s, and she's dealing with dryness of the eyes.
Mm-hmm.
She's dealing with dryness of the eyes. They keep giving her drops. Then along with that, recently, and she's very healthy. She's been healthy in the past. Along with that, they've saying now that she has some acid reflux or some type of GI situation. I've noticed that her skin looks very dry to me, drier than I've seen it. And for my reading, I was saying to her, you know, they keep giving you a prescription for this and a prescription for that, and it seems like Band-Aids to me. Could it be possible that the eye dryness, whatever you're dealing with, gastro, that it's all connected, even with the skin, you know, that there's something going on?
Right.
Do you think that there are a lot of irregularities that can happen in your health, even when you're dealing with that decrease in hormone that may not be detected or not be, you know, identified by the medical field?
Well, I think that there's a couple of things going on.
Okay.
One is that as we age, we have more of an issue with trying to maintain what's called balance or homeostasis.
Okay.
So as we age, what tends to happen is that we drink less water, because we don't want to go to the bathroom as much.
Right.
Also, we make less digestive enzymes as we age.
Ooh. We have
so
a caller. We have
I think, and then you don't know if the dry eyes are due to side effects for some of the medication she's taking.
That's a really good point.
So there are a few things to tease out there.
Okay. Let's see. Do we have a caller? Okay. They'll let us know. They'll plug it in.
Okay,
that's a really good point. So now you get that prescription. Do you just fill it? Because I think sometimes we get the prescriptions, we fill it, and we really don't read that leaflet with all of the side effects that's in there.
Yeah. Well, you know, not having all of the details is kind of hard to answer that question
specifically.
But, you know, start trying to think a little bit outside of the box and try to figure out, well, you know, start taking inventory on what a person does do as far as their eating habits, water intake habits, sleep habits, because all of those are very important.
Okay. Now, in your practice, do you see a lot of young women?
I do.
You do see a lot of young women. Are you seeing an increase of anything that is of concern to you among young women, especially even young women of color?
I think a lot of amongst young women, I just see a lot of lack of education about their bodies.
Okay.
And I can't even say that's just about young women. I can say about, you know, older women too.
That we did it like you and I. I'm not in that category.
Yeah.
I'm not
well,
older.
Not you. Well, I'm older. And grateful to be here.
Yes, yes.
But I will say just basic things to me that are basic, and maybe they're not really basic, but some basic things that we should know about our bodies, like, say, for example, what normal discharge is, what normal vaginal discharge is.
Right.
You know, because that changes during the month. That changes during the cycle.
Okay.
So women don't know about that. And I see, you know, a lot of young women, they come in and I think that they have confidence issues in having their partner use a condom.
Okay.
And it's, you know, I feel like part of my job a lot of times is just to educate a young lady on, you know, being proactive and taking a little bit more charge of her health and her sexuality and her body. Mm-hmm. But I see, and I think that, to me, I think the biggest thing, and your audience may be like, okay, she's strange, but to me, the biggest thing is that people don't move their bowels enough.
No, let me tell you.
And that is so critical.
Let me tell you, my husband's probably going to be watching this, and he calls me, and I'll say it, the poop specialist, because I'm always talking about it. It's really important.
It is.
And the analogy I use is, what happens if we never take out the garbage in the kitchen and we just keep putting stuff on top of
it's
it?
The same thing I say.
Yeah, over and over again. We do that and we think it's okay.
Right.
So talk to us about that.
So the analogy, similar analogy that I use in my practice is that would you leave the garbage piling up in your house for days and days and days without taking it out? The same thing happens internally, except not only is it starting to smell bad, but also things that are packaged to go out are getting reabsorbed.
Reabsorbed, wow.
Reabsorbed.
Wow.
And sometimes if hormonally, you know, some hormones get reactivated. So, you know, our body doesn't only get rid of things that's waste from what we've eaten or what we drank, as it also gets rid of toxins that we get exposed to just in our normal daily lives of being around cars and exhaust. Whether you're driving a car or not, you're getting exposed to exhaust every single day.
Wow.
Right? Even if you're walking in New York City streets, you know, you're smelling exhaust every day, as well as whatever other chemicals are in the air. And depending on where you live, that might be more or less, depending on what kind of factories are near you. So every day we're getting exposed to toxins that our liver has to process and handle, detoxify, and it ships it out through the poop.
Wow.
And if you're not pooping, it's not going anywhere and it's staying and getting reabsorbed. And you don't want that.
Fermenting in the body.
You don't want that, because now your liver has to work double time, triple time.
Wow. Okay, so give us, because we want to be able to work with what we got.
Yeah.
Say we have these bad habits. Say we have the coffee addictions.
Sure.
Or, you know, say we have dealing with obesity, ignorance about our bodies. What are some like three basic steps, you know, reboot 101.
Okay.
That we could start with.
Number one.
One.
H2O.
Water.
Plain old-fashioned water. Mm-hmm. You gotta have it every day. So, baseline minimum to strive for, just the baseline. So this is not even including if you've had any caffeine or if you exercise and sweat, because in those circumstances, then you need even more than the baseline.
Right.
So the baseline amount of water that an individual needs every day is whatever the body weight is, divided in half, and that's the amount of ounces that a person needs.
Okay.
On a daily basis.
Okay.
So if I have, so if I were to have 2 10-ounce cups of coffee.
Yes.
I would need 4 10-ounce cups of water to replace
just the coffee.
The water that I lost just from the caffeine intake.
And then half of the body weight on top of that.
Exactly.
Wow. Okay.
Exactly.
The other
so
two.
That would be number one. Mm-hmm. Number two would be the first medicine that anybody has on a daily basis that they don't think about that way is what's on their plate. Mm. So those lovely snacks that you made, that's part of it.
Right.
So outside of just the snacks, whatever else you're eating, what's on your plate?
Yes.
So you want to make sure that you're getting a substantial amount of vegetables, because that helps our bodies to detoxify.
Okay.
And to heal.
Yes.
So, you know, become a vegetable queen or king.
Yeah. We say that on here a lot. Eat the rainbow. Eat the rainbow.
That's it. And I tell my patients, I tell them, eat the rainbow, but I'm not talking about Skittles.
Yeah. Okay, we have water. We have watching what we eat.
Yes.
And what's the third thing?
The third thing is sleep.
Sleep.
Because that's when our body will do some of its most important work, which is repair and restore.
Okay.
So 5 hours of sleep is not enough. 7 or 8 is probably better, a lot better. And don't eat before you go to sleep. That's a big no-no, especially if there's a weight issue.
Yes.
But the other thing that happens is that if we are eating, say, 9 o'clock at night or after, really we should stop eating by maybe 7 o'clock.
I had a neighbor. 7:30. They used to do that. She wouldn't eat after 7 o'clock.
Yeah. And really that meal should be light. It shouldn't be the biggest meal of the day.
Okay.
Biggest meal of the day should be lunch.
Right.
And dinner should be a light meal, something easy to digest, vegetables.
Excellent.
You know, and you want to have at least 3 hours between your meal and your bedtime. So that doesn't mean eat at 9 o'clock and go to bed 3 hours later.
Right.
Because the body wants to start its cleanup work, like maybe 10-ish.
Wow.
But if you're digesting food, if the body has to divert itself to digest food, then it's not going to start the repair and restorative work that it needs to do.
Wow. I have so many questions for you. I got to have you come back.
Okay. I'd love to.
Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate
again,
it.
Tell me again the name of your practice in Livingston, New Jersey.
It's called Women and Wellness.
Okay. And you're located where?
It's 349 East Northfield Road, Livingston, New Jersey. And the phone number is 973-758-9311.
Excellent. Okay. Well, I am so glad that we had Dr. Howard on. You heard
it
her
was
information.
A pleasure.
You also can visit our website, and you'll be able to find other contact information there on our website, which is www.burningbushfamily.com. Now, you know we end every show with a story, and when Dr. Howard was talking, it brought back to my mind about how you can't ignore things. Basically, that's a lot of what she was saying. You can't ignore your health. And I'm telling you, I used to be the ignore queen, not even deal with health, just with issues, because you know I like to talk about issues. And I can remember probably about more than 25 years ago, more than 25, more like 28 years ago, I remember moving out from my parents' home, and I went to go live with two of my best friends. And I remember my dad saying, Renee, you shouldn't live with anybody unless you can afford to pay the rent yourself. No, Dad, these are my best friends. We love each other. We're going to be together forever. Renee, don't move out. Dad, you just don't want me to grow up. You always try to keep me, treat me like a baby. Well, the roommate situation lasted 60 days. 60 days, and they moved out. And I was stuck with this brownstone in Brooklyn by myself. And I would not admit that I couldn't afford it by myself. Now, I lived on the top floor, and the owner lived on the bottom floor. And different times the month would come around, and I didn't have money for my rent. So I would stay in the apartment and stay really still, thinking that maybe she didn't know I was up there. And she would hit the ceiling, and she'd say, Renee, I know you're up there. Come down. And I would stay really still and think, okay, if she goes to sleep, then I could sneak and go out. Renee, I know you're up there. And I did that for a while. And then November came around. I did it for about 7-8 months, trying to handle this 3-bedroom brownstone apartment in Brooklyn by myself, going to school and working some little part-time job, because I did not want to admit to my dad that he was right. Well, finally, after doing it for about 8 months, I realized I had to move back home. And there were my parents with loving arms saying, just come on back home, eat crow, all is well. Well, I get a notice in the mail. I get a notice in the mail from my best friends saying that I owed them, and they were taking me to court for a judgment saying I owed them a deposit on the apartment. I owed them month's security. I didn't owe you no security. You left me. I let the security out. Well, we end up having to go to court. Who was with me? My parents were with me. The judge said, well, you didn't owe them 2 months security. You just give them 1 month each. My father turns around. He gives me $500. He says, you give $250 to so-and-so. You give $250 to so-and-so. It's a lesson learned. I took the $250 from him. I said, okay, Dad. And he left. And I held on to that money. I said, they're not getting nothing from me. I'm not giving them check. They're going to have to come get me. They moved out on me. And I held on to that $500. I think I spent it. I shopped. I did whatever. Renee, did you pay them? Yes, Dad, I paid them. Guess what? Talk about ignoring. It must have been probably about 10 years later. I'm married now, and I go to buy a house. When I go to buy a house, they run your name, and there's a huge judgment on me. There's a lien. That $250 a piece that I needed, I ended up having to give close to like $1,000 to those roommates because I ignored it. And I had to pay it or else I couldn't close on my house. Imagine what happens when our minds are so knotted up with being right. Our minds are so knotted up with being justified. Our minds are so knotted up with proving a point. Mm-hmm. Our minds are so knotted up. And that's how we can be with our health. That's how we can toxic. We can be with our relationships. That's how we can be with our finances. That's how we can be with our families. And I'm telling you, free your mind and the rest will follow.
Amen.
Thank you for joining. See you next week.
I love that.
Yeah. That was great.